द नेक्स्ट चैप्टर ऑफ द ऑडियो बुक ऑफ द गो गिवर इज सूजन. व्हेन जो रिटर्न टू हिज ऑफिस दैट आफ्टरनून थिंग्स वर इन चाओस. देयर कंप्यूटर सिस्टम हैड गोन डाउन फॉर अ फ्यू मिनट्स एंड इन द प्रोसेस ऑफ गेटिंग इट बैक ऑनलाइन 3 days ऑफ अकाउंट रिकॉर्ड्स एंड कॉरेस्पॉन्डेंस हैड बीन लॉस्ट. एवरीवन वाज फ्रेंटिकली पुलिंग फाइल्स एंड रिस्टोरिंग इंफॉर्मेशन टू द सिस्टम फ्रॉम हार्ड कॉपीज. एज जो जॉइंड हिज टीम एंड प्लोड into the growing stack of paper, all thoughts of Sam Rosen, Pinder and the law of influence evaporated. It was nearly 7 when he finally closed his paper-stuffed briefcase, picked it up with a groan and headed for the elevator. He dropped into the seat of his car, his mind still churning on his work. The next thing he knew, he was pulling into his driveway 25 minutes later. He switched off the engine and sat listening to the clink, clink, clink of the cooling engine. He wished there were an ignition key that would switch off his mind. Was he wasting his time with these daily lunchtime lessons and law of stratospheric success he was supposedly learning? Was any of this getting him closer to making that third quarter quota he so badly needed to make? He looked at the front door of his suburban duplex and sighed. Susan would have been home for an hour already. She would be just as exhausted as he was, and her afternoon would have been just as hard as his. He found Susan in the kitchen, pulling something from the oven. She didn't need to tell him that he was late, or that their dinner was a little dried out, or that she was too tired to care one way or the other. Her body language said all that and more. Over a listless dinner, notes were compared and miseries tallied as the two moved through the meal and kitchen cleanup. Joe wanted to tell her all about his appointment at the imposing Liberty office building, but he gave up without even trying. Last Saturday, when Joe had returned home and told her his first impression of Pinder, Susan had been intrigued, but at dinner on Monday, when he tried to tell her about Ernesto, she said only, "So this guy is actually the owner." She repeated this a few times and couldn't seem to get any deeper into his story. Yesterday, when he started telling her about Nicole Martin's kindergarten conference room, she rolled her eyes and said, "You are kidding." It went no further. Joe and Susan had established a sort of unwritten rule. They both had high-stress jobs and would arrive home for the evening in knots, each with at least a solid hour or two of extra office work to do. The unwritten rule was this: we each get up to 30 minutes of complaint time, no more. Tonight, Susan was already well into her half hour. Joe sat on the edge of their bed, doing his best to stay sympathetic while Susan paced and talked. Inwardly, he sighed again, wondering what he could possibly say that would make her feel better. Suddenly, Joe realized that Susan had stopped talking mid-sentence and was looking at him. "I'm sorry," she said softly. "It is almost 80:30. A tired sigh. "I guess I am a bottomless pity party." A wan attempt at a smile. "I know you have got work to get to." She turned away and said, more to herself than to him, "Fear is fear." Joe opened his mouth to speak, then closed it again. Fear is there. What did that remind him of? And why did it sound so wrong? 50-50 is losing proposition. It was Sam, of course, even Steven. "I scratched your back, so now you owe me. That is not being a friend, that is being a creditor." Was that what their marriage had become? Without thinking about what he was going to say, he blurred out, "No, Sus. Wait, actually I don't." She turned back and looked at him. "Please go on," he said. "I would like to hear about what happened really." For a moment, Susan looked at Joe as if he had told her that the law of gravity had just been revoked. "Really?" "Sure," he said. "I mean, it sounded like it was pretty rough." "So what did you say?" His wife sat next to him on the bed and looked at him again. "Really?" he said. "My stuff will wait." Susan slowly began to talk again about her day, about an especially nasty conflict she was having with a co-worker. After a few minutes, she stopped mid-sentence again and looked at Joe. He nodded and waited for her to go on. She lay back again the pillow and began to pour her heart out. She talked about how long this difficult situation at work had been bringing, why it hurts her so, how lost she was as to what to do about it, how it made her feel. 20 minutes later, she was crying. Joe was mortified. He had been listening carefully, but she would talk about so many different issues and covered so much ground. He was not sure exactly which thing she was crying about. It seemed as if for Susan everything was wrong. He lay down and put his arm around her awkwardly, but her weeping continued. He murmured a few attempts at word of comfort, feeling foolish all the while. What was it Gus had said? Sometimes you feel foolish, even look foolish, but you do the things anyway. Finally, her sobbing turns to sniffing, and then that stopped too. Joe felt immense relief. Perhaps his words were not so foolish after all. They seemed to have given her some comfort at least, or perhaps she was just thinking. "Hey," he said, "love you." Susan said nothing, so he stirred her gently. She was asleep. He hadn't heard any of his words of comfort. She would just cry herself to sleep. Feeling useless and defeated, Joe quietly got himself ready for bed and slipped under the covers, wrapped in a quiet egg for Susan's misery and wishing he could have done something to take away its sting. He eventually drifted off. The next morning, he awoke with a start and lurched from the deep sleep into sudden horrified realization. Yesterday's lesson, what was it? Sam Rosen, networking, an army of personal walking ambassadors. The law of influence. He had gone from work to home to bed and passed the night away without even thinking about the day's lesson, let alone trying to apply it. He groaned and grabbed his pillow, meaning to throw it across the room in frustration, but as he did, he realized that Susan was not in the bed next to him. He glanced at the clock, 8:15. He had overslept. Susan must have crept out of bed and left the house without talking to him, without even bothering to wake him. He groaned again. He would blow on Pinder's lesson. He was late for work and he was on the outs with Susan. "Three strikes, Joe," he muttered. Pinder's words echoed in his mind. "If you don't abide by my condition, our meeting will come to an end." He dragged himself upright with sinking thoughts about calling Brenda to cancel his lunch appointment with Winter, and then he glanced at Susan's pillow and noticed a piece of paper folded in half with a single word written on the outside. "Sweetheart." When was the last time Susan had called him that? Come to think of it, when was the last time Susan had written him a note? He picked it up and opened it. "My sweet Joe, I hope I succeeded in sleeping out without waking you. You deserve the extra rest after the earful I gave you last night. Thank you so much. Thank you for your generosity. Generosity, my sweet love." He read the rest of the note. "I can't remember ever feeling so listened to, so hard. I love you." Joe was at a loss. Generosity. What had he been generous about? He looked back at the note, scanning it for answers. "Thank you for your generosity. I can't remember ever feeling so listened to." He rubbed his face, amazed. It was not about complaining at all. She just wanted him to listen, just wanted to be heard. All at once, he remembered that voice like a creaking gate. He stopped keeping score, and then he laughed. He had done the homework. And this is the end of this chapter. The next chapter is The Law of Authenticity. Thank you.